As somewhat of an underdog in the annals of cult British horror cinema, I see Norman J. Warren as a source of great inspiration to myself due to his determination and inventiveness in the face of tight schedules, small budgets, and unfinished scripts. Right from his first theatrical feature, Her Private Hell, which was touted as Britain's first scandalous narrative sex film, Warren's cinema has always excelled strongly in the area of inventively marketed exploitation fare. And with other titles sparked with such sheer lurid fascination as Satan's Slave, Bloody New Year, and Inseminoid, and also featuring equally lurid poster designs, it's hard for one not to be at least a little intrigued. With this video channel in mind, I'd intended to eventually make a video on Norman Warren's cinema, but with the recent sad news of his passing earlier this month at the age of 78, I decided to make it my first project. Following an independent and quite stylishly shot black and white short fragment, his aforementioned feature-length debut, Her Private Hell, was incidentally the first of Warren's films that I saw, thanks to its inclusion in the BFI's Fantastic Flipside range, a strand which has uncovered many fantastic and forgotten British obscurities, primarily from the 60s and 70s.
No wonder he's sleeping.
I wouldn't say that Her Private Hell is the most representative film of his career, and it's certainly by no means as scandalous as the marketing originally suggested, but nonetheless it's a stylish enough, sexually charged melodrama about one woman's descent into the cruel depths of the fashion modelling world of the 1960s. Shot with a very European arthouse sensibility and featuring an endearing and empathetic lead performance by Lucia Medina. It's interesting to note that the two saucier scenes of sexualised nudity in the film, most notably a nude photo shoot and a rather stylized swinging party sequence, are actually owing to the slightly more risque alternative takes that were filmed for the American audiences, as prolonged sights of bare breasts were still too scandalous for us prudish Brits back then, so we had to make do with a more implied version of events instead. This was followed by another title promising saucy escapades in the form of Loving Feeling in 1968, which is a pretty droll melodrama about the adulterous exploits of a London disc jockey and his wife's secret liaisons. This time we're in colour, and it's a bit more risque than Her Private Hell, with numerous sex scenes, but sadly it's just nowhere near as visually interesting or even as sexy. It has a couple entertaining moments, but these are mostly all for the unintended reasons, owing to the slapdash overdubbing of badly written dialogue and amusingly stilted acting.
Yes, he's there, all right. With his flat and his girlfriends.
Shut up about his girlfriend. Who do you think you are?
I'm your lover. Do you understand that? Love.
There's also a rather bizarre dream sequence where our protagonist rolls about between his various lovers and sexual conquests, which I didn't quite know what to make of, to be perfectly honest.
Some people are more sensitive to their surroundings than others, aren't they?
Are they?
Yes. It's hereditary, an ability to pick up certain vibrations.
I sometimes have premonitions.
Do they come true?
With the concerns of being pigeonholed as just another British sex film director, Warren turned down offers to direct another similar work, before carving out his true path some years later with his third feature, Satan's Slave, released in 1976. Filmed mostly in and around the estate of a manor house in Surrey, Satan's Slave is a quintessentially 70s dive into rural gothica, occultism and devil worship, with a decent helping of horror, gore, salacious nudity and human sacrifice. It's notable that this, along with the rest of Warren's cinema and that of his rival Pete Walker, were among the first British horror films to have a contemporary setting, rather than the usual historical romanticised gothic fare of Hammer Horror and Amicus Studios, that us Brits have become steadily familiar with. These films also really upped the ante when it came to sex, violence and bloodshed, as the realms of permissibility had forever been altered in the early 70s, thanks to films like A Clockwork Orange, Straw Dogs and Ken Russell's fiery masterpiece The Devils. Of course, this newfound permissibility and let adults actually decide what they want to watch ideology would famously regress and shrivel away a few years later, once the early 80s rolled in, the video nasty scandal forced British classification into its most draconian state until the late 90s. But I digress. Satan's Slave is a very solid work, and it's the right ticket to please the seasoned gorehound who's after something akin to 70s Euro horror with its phantasmagorical blending of outlandish occult themes and vividly visceral imagery, with a modern setting and a decidedly British flavour. Then there's Prey, which was made in 1977, which is an even lower budget sci-fi horror that centres on a reclusive lesbian couple who invite a male stranger into their private estate after they find him squatting in a nearby forest on one of their walks. Of course, appearances can often be deceptive, as we witnessed in the start of this film, as this male stranger is in fact a bloodthirsty extraterrestrial who has been sampling local wildlife in search for a viable new food source for his species. It's probably the most Marmite of all his films due to the confined setting, tiny cast and campish overacting, but there is a surprising amount of fun still to be had as long as you have a tolerance for the above. The general vibe is vaguely reminiscent of cult British sci-fi curiosity Extra, and the interactions between our alien stranger and the bickering couple create some fascinatingly awkward and squirm-inducing dialogue exchanges that are rather masochistically entertaining to watch, especially when they descend into moments of sheer intense screeching lunacy.
London, I'm coming with you. I've had enough. I can't stand anymore. I'm leaving.
Jessica!
It just doesn't work.
You're going too far this time.
I'm leaving, you bitch! Jessica! It's too late!
Don't leave me!
Warren's fifth feature film, Terror, is his personal ode to Italian surreal horror fare like Dario Argento's Suspiria. His self-confessed intention with Terror was to orchestrate a bunch of fresh and inventive death scenes, with the plot being more of an afterthought to string them all together. And I'd say that it still works wonderfully well as a cohesive film. Starting off with the red herring of a gruesome historical set Mario Bava-esque witch-burning sequence that is quickly revealed to be a film within a film, Terror manages to successfully blend the occult, the macabre and the weird into one wholesome and very modern package. Amongst the campy acting and the A to Z of horror tropes, there's lots to enjoy here. Personal high points for me include a riotously over-the-top scene of a possessed porn film set, as well as a wonderfully bizarre S&M striptease in a sleazy Soho bar. They don't make them like this anymore, do they? Warren dabbled in sci-fi yet again in 1979 with his sixth feature film, a space-themed sex comedy called Spaced Out. The setup is quite simple. A couple and two other strangers get abducted to an alien spaceship inhabited by three sexually inquisitive extraterrestrial humanoid females, then rude hijinks ensue.
What are these creatures doing anyway? Looks like a combat technique to me.
No, it's a sport.
Oh, nonsense. It's hand-to-hand combat.
I disagree. I think it's a religious rite or ceremony. I mean, look at the expression of ecstasy on that face.
Well, here's an expression of agony.
There are many highlights, almost all owing to the funky design of the film and the constantly smirk-inducing dialogue. It's silly, it's camp, it truly revels in its premise, and it's just a good bit of fun, really.
Why don't you and I... Are you married?
What's that?
Nothing. Nothing. It's just that I only stack shelves in the supermarket at the moment. But you never know. In a couple of years, I might become the assistant manager.
Continuing the science fiction premises, but going back to the horror genre, 1981 would see the release of Warren's most commercially successful feature, in Seminoid. Part financed by Hong Kong Shaw Brothers Production, whose roster includes many diverse genre films like Hex, Black Magic and the fantastically over-the-top Seeding of a Ghost, Inseminoid in turn has the biggest budget of Warren's films. It did, however, also have the unfortunate cursed blessing of being bestowed with the most ludicrously excessive poster design that the film could unfortunately never possibly have hoped to live up to. Still, not the worst cinema movie could make, and there are far worse alien ripoffs out there. Inseminoid boasts some nice design work here and there, of a couple great scenes featuring some neat practical effects work. The creature designs in this film are also top-notch, but unfortunately used far too fleetingly. The film's infamous impregnation scene, whilst nowhere near as inventive as Aliens, is still surprisingly creepy and a little uncomfortable to watch. His next endeavour was certainly the most atypical of all his films, 1986's Gunpowder. It's a jocular and still thoroughly British riff on the pulpy escapist spy formula, featuring two secret agents named Gun and Powder, tasked with taking down an evil megalomaniac who intends to cause a global economic crash of his gold manufacturing operation. It'll hardly set your world on fire, but it doesn't take itself in the least bit seriously, and there's enough amusing and relatively entertaining moments to sustain most of its 80-minute runtime, including this little snippet, which is frankly one of the most bizarre moments of courtship on film that I've ever seen.
Stilton.
Edam.
Stilton.
Edam. Edam. Edam.
Mozzarella.
Camembert.
Cavilli?
His last feature film, 1987's Bloody New Year, is easily the campest and most surreal of his horror features. Possibly the most negatively received and reviewed of all his films, I think that it's actually a touch underrated. A carnivalesque melding of various horror tropes and ideas featuring quite a diverse array of set pieces, some of which have a rather Cronenbergian plastic reality vibe to them, which I really admire from a practical effects perspective. There's a particular sequence in an elevator that feels like it could have easily come right out of a Nightmare on Elm Street film. The casting isn't great, it is one of the most god-awful pop songs repeated in it that my ears have ever had to suffer through, and the plot makes little to no sense with a lot of ideas that were seemingly thrown at the canvas in an attempt to see what sticks. But there was still something rather admirable about it regardless. Much of the film has a totally dreamlike feel to it, because of the sheer weirdness of it all. In fact, I'd say that it's best watched in the dead of night, in a sleep-deprived state, to get the best experience. He would pretty much retire from the director's chair from this point on, presumably due to difficulties in financing and bankability from the 90s onwards, as evidenced by other directors of his ilk, like Pete Walker and Ken Russell, but his enthusiastic presence within the horror film world would still be felt in other capacities, be it through getting involved with various horror festivals, screening events, and even stepping into the producer role, like with 2018's Susu, a rather interesting sounding mix of suspenseful gothic mystery, crime drama and horror that I'll be sure to check out at some point. It's been great to see a steady reappreciation of his work in recent years, thanks largely to the efforts of boutique film labels like Vinegar Syndrome in the US and Powerhouse Films here in the UK. The Bloody Terror box set that was released over here in the UK not too long ago is a true labour of love, with each of his five key horror films presented in gorgeous high definition. Each film is also rife with extra content, including extensive interviews and commentaries from the man himself, offering many fascinating new insights into the films and unheard stories from behind the camera. It's not super often that a director such as Norman Warren, who never truly reached the height and popularity of his American contemporaries like George Romero, John Carpenter or David Cronenberg, would get the chance to see and be involved in a modern renaissance and re-evaluation of their work amongst the canon of horror. We are lucky to have gotten so much insight from such a passionate and enthusiastic director, and it's a pleasing notion that Warren lived to see his films get rediscovered by a new generation of rabid horror fans like myself and many others.